in recent months, I've been asked a number of times by entrepreneurs around the world as to what the best operating model for a treasury function in a bank would look like. And because there are a number of alternatives that can be considered, it's worth being aware of what the alternatives are so that the Asset Liability Committee, or indeed the Board of Directors, can review on a regular basis, say once a year or every 2 years, the operating model currently in place, and then debate and agree on whether it's fit for purpose still or whether it needs to be modified in some way. So let's begin. First of all, a stylized depiction of the bank treasury itself. Here we have a bank, traditional style, with the columns, and this bank has three business lines: retail business, corporate banking, and wholesale banking. And there's a treasury function atop that, which deals internally with the business lines. So in effect, it's like the internal clearinghouse, or the bank within a bank. And the business lines manage cash flows from their customers in or out. Treasury then clears all that for them. The treasury function may have an external market-facing function as well, as we see that on the left-hand side, dealing with market counterparties in the money markets for cash and derivatives, and also for structural balance sheet hedging of interest rate and foreign exchange and other market risks. So what does this mean then for the treasury function or the treasury operating? First of all, there's no one right operating model. There are many ways to approach this, and so the important thing for us to be aware of: do we have the one that is most appropriate for our bank? Do we have the most appropriate treasury operating model in place? And the factors that you may want to consider are: first, should it have an external market-facing market access fund and P&L target, or should it be restricted only to the internal middle office treasury function, the asset liability management function, or should it do both? I must admit, doing both is common, but there are a number of variations that one can observe. And we're going to do this by reference, or with reference, to two textbooks. In the first place, the Principles of Banking. The reference here is chapter 10 of that book, and the following slides are extracts from that book. First of all, what is the scope of potential treasury activity and responsibility? There's a large list of activities there. Not every treasury function does all of them, but some functions will do some of these. So the first question to address is, okay, which of these should be sat in treasury and which of these should be sat elsewhere in other parts of the bank? And once you've agreed this, you end up with either a front office treasury function or a middle office treasury function hybrid, a function that does a bit of both. And that's the examples we show here. First of all, the orthodox front office treasury operating model that manages external market access, wholesale market issuance, say the medium-term notes, as well as money markets, collateral management and wholesale counterparty risk management, as well as the liquidity risk and interest rate risk in the banking book function as well. So that orthodox front office treasury model. Another example is the middle office treasury operating model, which doesn't have the market access function, but looks after capital, liquidity risk management and interest rate risk. Indeed, the M function, in other words, as well as some element of financial management or treasury finance and treasury risk management. Regulatory reporting may sit within treasury, or in some banks it's required to sit out treasury function due to regulatory requirement. And here's a hybrid. This is a middle office treasury function that is also responsible for term liabilities issuance into the wholesale markets. So the orthodox front office model looks a bit like this, with the head of treasury reporting to the CEO. You've got the market access function on the left-hand side, money markets and hedgepo, then balance sheet management and also liquidity management. And as you can see, within liquidity management, we have a funds transfer pricing and liquidity adequacy responsibility, the ILAP. And on balance sheet management, also the ICAP, the capital adequacy responsibility as well. And here is what your template for the front office target operating model might look like. Would basically assign full-time employees to each part of the treasury desk. Some banks add to their treasury function a kind of treasury sale function. This is basically leveraging off the expertise and the center of excellence for ALM from the treasury function, or leveraging off that to assist the business lines in attaining their customer origination. So for example, assisting or advising or working directly with the corporate bank relationship manager to facilitate a corporate customer hedging transaction, example, for foreign exchange risk management. So using the treasury function to help facilitate customer business via this treasury sales desk, again, part of the treasury function. That would also be front office treasury, but you've an active customer angle to that as well, bank customer angle. So the considerations, therefore, are, first of all, what's the scope of responsibility? What are we actually responsible for? Entry, and I showed you the slide at the beginning, that whole various areas of responsibility. How centralized or decentralized should it be, where you've got a multi-legal entity or multinational function or group, a banking group, you know, with different subsidiaries and branches outside of one jurisdiction? What's the reporting line? Commonly for front office treasury, it is to the CEO, but not necessarily always. In middle office treasuries, it's common in the UK to see the treasurer report to the CFO, the finance head, but less common outside of the UK, I observe. Rarely, I have seen reporting lines into other C-suite, and on one occasion, I've seen a dotted reporting line, a dual reporting line, into a board NED as well. So there's the scope of ownership, centralization aspect of it across multinational entities, and also how it interacts with the various business lines. And these all lines, and these all need to be reviewed on a regular basis and agreed at ALCO for it to the board of directors. So to summarize, the treasury function itself is obviously an important part of any bank, and we want to have comfort. We want to have comfort that what it undertakes is the appropriate business model. How it undertakes what it does is the appropriate business model for our bank in question. So the P&L angle of it, what of the ALM function it manages, and how much market access it has. And the point at the bottom is to reiterate, the treasury function can and should also assist the business where possible, acting as a center of excellence to advise and help them facilitate customer business, whether it's with corporate customers or indeed retail customers. Now, the remainder of this presentation, I'm going to reference another textbook, Moorad Choudhry Anthology. Coincidentally, the reference there is also chapter 10. That is pure coincidence because the books are 6 years apart in publication date. Remaining slides are extracts from this book. And all I wanted to add here was a group setup, where you do have a group function, because the bank has series and or branches in other jurisdictions, it's important to get the standardization and the group treasury policy in place, and then local treasury managing to that to the group, but also having exceptions with approval where required. If you have sufficient breadth and depth across a number of entities overseas, then sometimes you're setting up a regional ALCO to manage the region's various local ALCOs. So a local treasury function, whether it's a branch or a subsidiary, a local ALCO overseeing that under group treasury and group ALCO policy and standardization. And that's essentially what slide 16 is saying as well. What's important is to get the group treasury policy and standardization in place, and exceptions to be approved in advance. So where there is any moving away from the group treasury policy, that's noted and approved in advance. Really want to make sure that the local function is managing its balance sheet appropriately under group treasury guidance and under local ALCO guidance as well. I always think it's important for the local treasury to have as much autonomy as possible, as is desirable, because of course they're the experts on the ground who are close to their local regulatory requirements and local issues like that branch or subsidiary's high quality liquid asset buffer. So as much autonomy as possible, I find, is always produces the best results, but under the group treasury policy. Okay, so that's where we conclude. I hope you've enjoyed this short presentation. There's more than one way to set up the treasury operating model, and what's important is that we set it up in a way that's appropriate for our bank in question. And of course, the asset liability committee should review this operating model on a regular basis, let's say every 2 years, or if you wish, every year, to make sure that it's always the right one for the bank in question.